There's going to be at least 14 new faces on city council next year, and it seems that I could up that number every week between retirement announcements, early exits, aldermen leaving their seats to run for mayor. What's driving this, Tom Allen?
Well, that's that question, I think, is part a sign of our times. The conflict, the uncertainty, you know, across our country, with you know, starting with the George Floyd, throw in the pandemic, everybody is nervous. People are locked in their houses. They're acting out on the roadways. You can see it on the roadways, and I think that's just kind of bled into everybody's personalities. And when you're working it with a group on the city council, you have to get along. You have to talk. You have to cooperate. You have to, you know, compromise. And I think people are just locked in their silos, and that's just not in government. That's just across across our country and across even the world. So I think there's a loss of camaraderie and kind of friendship. When we were on the council, the folks that are sitting here, we had different viewpoints, but we always were respectful. I mean, we had we got together socially. I mean, matter of fact, we did softball games against the press. We used to do that. We had Christmas parties. We had basketball games. We did. Remember the boxing match that we put? Matter of fact, Larry Potash, I got a bone to pick.
Well, he may be watching this.
Yeah,
so
well, he took part in that, and he took it too seriously, and he was pounding one of our guys, I remember.
Or maybe that'll get edited out. Yeah, I'm not sure. That's possible.
But anyhow, so the point is, we spoke to each other, and it doesn't look like in this environment that I see now that they're doing that. And so if you're not having fun, what do? You leave. So they're not having fun.
So, Marge, I'm going to switch the question and go to Joe. But, Marge, what about you? So it seems pandemic-related and all the tensions that have been triggered?
Certainly it does. But, you know, basically I think incumbency has a tendency to be a problem here. You know, usually there's, you know, two electoral themes. It's usually keep its experience or throw the bums out. And in this case, I think you might have a situation where the members of the current city council, especially those that have a little time under their belt, the incumbency issue is not going to be a good one for them. I also feel that it's basically a generational change. You know, we're coming to a time when, you know, obviously the older members of the city council are getting ready to retire. And you know what? New blood is good. But on the other hand, I'm concerned that some of the long-term tradition and historical knowledge in the city council is going to be lost. But I also want to say that the public is very restless. And I'm not sure that they even know, the electorate knows what they're looking for. And it's just a time of discontent. And I think that is the reason that a lot of alderpersons are leaving the city council.
Joe Moore, let me just build on that a little bit. Even Mayor Lightfoot said this past week that city council isn't exempt from the so-called great resignation. And saying it's just a tough time to be a public servant and an incumbent at that, as Marge was saying. While you weren't in city government during the pandemic, can you talk about the unique pressures that aldermen feel and get as compared to other elected officials?
Well, we are, as aldermen, we were the first line of defense. We are the folks that our constituents would call for any issue, whether it was regarding city services or a landlord-tenant dispute or problem with their unemployment check or with their social security check, whatever the case was, they would call us, and then it would be up to us to you know, contact the appropriate authorities. So, and we were always the first ones to be blamed when something went wrong, even if we had nothing to do with it. Because, you know, I guess in many respects, familiarity breeds contempt, as the old saying goes. And since we're the elected officials closest to the people, we're the first ones to get blamed if things aren't going right in the minds of the voters. Because I've continued to work in the political sphere, not as an elected official, but as a consultant and lobbyist, I have continued to talk with my former colleagues, and they are unhappy. And I think they're unhappy because of, as Tom and Marge pointed out, the pressures of the civil unrest in the wake of the George Floyd murder and the and COVID and the stay-at-home orders. There is and a lack of comity, C-O-M-I-T-Y, in the city council, particularly, quite frankly, among some of the new members who are more interested, quite frankly, in getting on TV than trying to get anything done. And that's frustrating for those who are in the council who do want to try to get something accomplished, who do believe in that compromise is an important skill to have. And so that lends to frustration, and there are very many common themes as I talked to my former colleagues about why they're leaving, and those were certainly some of them.
And Pat, look, you spent 36 years on city council, and so as an offshoot of these other comments, one of the things Mayor Lightfoot promised when she came into office was to abolish the old Chicago way. And among that, what she was referring to was aldermanic prerogative. So as somebody who spent so many years on city council, talk about the importance of that. And are we better off with aldermen having or not having the kind of control that they've typically had through the decades?
Well, there's a difference between control of things that ultimately come to a vote and control of things that basically are administratively done. The prerogative that existed for administratively accomplished things was something that existed between administrators and the city council. And most of it would be of lesser importance, let's say. But the aldermanic prerogative at a voting level was essentially an acknowledgement that an alderman is elected in a geographic area. If this piece of legislation is going to affect that geographic area, one would presume that they knew best what was good for their neighborhood or not. One would presume that they were acting in good faith. And one would presume then that if it didn't matter to the voting, other voting members, then they would say, well, this is going to affect you, and this is your legislation, we'll give you the benefit of any doubts that are out there. I don't know that you ever get rid of that if you have a council that respects one another and gets along with one another and tries to cooperate with one another. But I don't think under the current situation you have to worry about that, because it doesn't sound like any of that's going on. So that prerogative is much more likely to be out the window than the administrative prerogative, which is basically an alderman being able to call a commissioner or a administrator and say, I really need this. Can you move this through your bureaucracy and get it done for me? Or this is a terrible thing. I need to talk to the law department and find out how we can prevent this. But in the meantime, please put the brakes on this, or please slow it down. That's a different situation. But aldermanic prerogative, people say it like it's something that's enshrined in law, and it's anything but. It's a courtesy amongst members, or it is a courtesy from an administrator to a member of the city council, who basically will be interacting with that department for the next 4 years once they're elected.
While I have you, Pat, you've got maybe the longest history. You go back to council wars. So I want to ask about something that happened recently and get some verification or not from you. Mayor Lightfoot recently referred to Eugene Sawyer as somebody who could be controlled by what she called the white racist mob back in those days. Now, Eugene Sawyer's son, Rod, who's now an alderman, he's running for mayor himself, he took issue with that description. What are your memories of that time? And was Lightfoot right or wrong about Eugene Sawyer being somebody who was selected to be controlled?
Well, the same could be said about Tim Evans, that he was being selected by a certain number of people because he could be controlled. So you could use that criticism and posit it as being the case for either one. Now, I'm not saying that either was correct, but because oftentimes we want race to be the overriding discussion point, this was that Gene Sawyer was being recommended by the majority of the white aldermen because they could control him, and that Tim Evans was being recommended by the African-American aldermen because there were people in the African-American political community that felt they could control him. Quite honestly, my recollection of that time, Gene enjoyed a significant amount of support initially across the board. But as the community, African-American community, black community galvanized around Tim Evans, it became politically impossible for the majority of those members to continue to be supportive of Gene Sawyer. But the initial meetings about who would be mayor, the initial discussions about who would be a mayor that could bring people together, Gene Sawyer was seen much more as a person who brought people together and talked and compromised than Tim was at that time. But those, you have to remember that when Mayor Washington was the mayor, an African-American alderman could never vote against something that the mayor wanted, or people would be upset throughout the community. They had one member came to a meeting in a hospital bed because he was afraid if he missed that vote, it could be construed as not supporting Mayor Washington. So there was a significant amount of concern among African-American elected officials at all strata in the community that if they were seen as not being loyal or supportive of Mayor Washington, that they would be ostracized and ultimately out. When he died, the fervor of trying to continue his legacy was so great that for a lot of the black aldermen at that time, it was even more potentially dangerous, because while Harold had the power, he very rarely used it to get vengeance or to make it difficult for someone that worked in the council. He was a very wise elected official and had been in government for a long time. But like today, there's very little constraint and very little lack of willingness to say the most hurtful or the worst thing. I think at that time, there was concern that that was being unleashed as well.
And just to button it up, so what you're saying is that Mayor Lightfoot's comments can be seen as one of appearance, that both sides, Tim Evans versus Gene Sawyer, could have been seen as one of appearance, but that's not what was going on?
I think that her statement, first of all, she wasn't around, so she wouldn't have a clue what was going on.
That's what Rod Sawyer said.
Okay.
That's why I'm asking you.
Yeah, and so I'm telling you that the initial meetings, the day that Mayor Washington passed away, Gene Sawyer had a significant amount of across-the-board support. It was only when the people who worked in the Washington administration gathered their forces that it became impossible for the majority of African Americans who would have otherwise supported Sawyer to actually be out publicly supporting him.
All right. Just before we leave Alderman prerogative, because I know that might be something that triggered all of you, does anybody else want to speak to the issue of alderman prerogative and how important that is? I'm guessing you do, sure. Joe, because that was based on the way you dealt with the community. That had to be important to you.
You know, aldermanic prerogative, or giving deference to an alderman on decisions affecting his or her ward, is a double-edged sword, no question about it. On the positive side, it gives the people in the community, through their elected representative, a lot of power to determine the future of their community. In my case, I had advisory committees and community meetings and solicited the opinions of my residents, my voters, before I made any any decision affecting a zoning issue or anything affecting my ward. And that's a good thing. That's grassroots democracy. That's giving people, through their elected representative, the one who knows them most, who's most accountable to them, the power to determine what happens in their community. Obviously, on the flip side, is you had aldermen who used that really unchecked power to enrich themselves. And that's why we're in a situation here today where we have folks talking about removing aldermanic prerogative. But as Pat noted, that's very difficult to do because it's not something that you find in the city code that you just simply introduce an ordinance to repeal aldermanic prerogative. Instead, it's an understanding among aldermen that the alderman in the ward where the issue is taking place has a much better handle on what's going on and knows best what they believe is best for their community. So I think we have to be very, very careful when we talk about removing aldermanic prerogative. Instead, we have to be more vigilant at investigating those and of bringing folks to justice who abuse that very important privilege.
Marge, I'm going to switch gears, although you want to
go ahead. I just wanted to say, sure, just very briefly, one of the most important things we did as aldermen is zoning issues. Once again, it is very important to our communities, the fact that all of us here, I know, worked very hard within the community to make sure that what was built or what wasn't built in our ward was reflective of the people that we represented. I just wanted to make sure that the zoning issue is...
I wanted to ask you, thank you for that. I want to ask you this because you were Mayor Pro Tem, so you understand the concept of city council working as a whole. So Alderman Ray Lopez, who wants to be mayor, one of the things he said is he'd like to see the size of city council cut in half. He's not the first person to suggest that. Mm-hmm. And give aldermen more oversight over city government. As somebody who might, you know, see over those meetings and all that. What is your thought about the cutting city council?
When I first heard him talk about that, I thought that maybe this was not a particularly good idea. If I'm not mistaken, Los Angeles has like maybe 15 aldermen, but they have a staff of probably, you know, 25 or 35 people. So I'm still one that would be inclined to represent a smaller area and be able to do that well.
Tom, you have a unique perspective because you're the only person here who's been a judge. So you have seen things from the bench. And I'm sort of curious, serving in that capacity, how did that inform you or shed light on how decisions you made as a judge varied from decisions that aldermen have to make, that city council makes?
Well, I served in a division called Chancery, and it's based on equity, and it gives a judge a lot more wiggle room than all the other parts of the law. And what I found was, well, first of all, you're always looking out, you know, as an alderman for your constituents, if there's an issue and they need help and they feel a certain way about, especially a zoning issue like Marge mentioned, and I'll just say this about alderman prerogative to digress. You know what that is? It's nothing more than you as the alderman are doing what your residents want, and that's what you do. So that's, I don't get it, this alderman prerogative. It's really democratic government, you know. The aldermen don't go out there promoting zoning changes that are opposed by their voters. So in any event, you try to be fair. But anyhow, on the bench, the problem is you're limited on the bench in making your decisions. You have to follow the law, okay? But as lawyers, Pat knows this too, in law school they teach you one day, here you're arguing this side of the case, next day you're arguing the opposite side, okay? And we all know that. So on the bench, it's very subjective. And I would think the alderman business is very subjective too. You take a pulse with your community, you do what they want to do. Here, I used to tell my law clerks I won't use the words I told them, but I used to tell them, I go, look, I said, you know, we have this dispute, and the different sides are fighting over facts and issues, and I would say we want to look at who's getting the short stick, okay, or who's getting screwed, and we want to unscrew them if possible, okay? And you can do that with the law if the law supports you. So basically, there was a lot of parallels to being an alderman. You know, you're trying to help people with their issues. There, you didn't have the law as restraints, but you had politics as restraint because, you know, politically you couldn't do certain things. But on the bench, our jurisprudence system works great in that regard, that, you know, a neutral person hears a dispute, both sides, and rules in favor of, in an equitable way, resolve the dispute, but it has to be backed up by the law. And so there are some parallels.
Okay.